glass explosion. I'll just explain that in a couple of minutes to you. Hopefully I won't speak for a couple of minutes. But I often, when we were in concert, used to have a couple of words with the audience because it's a habit we got into, and to make me feel more comfortable or to make you feel more comfortable. But if you don't know what a snark is now, when you leave this theatre, you still won't know. All I can tell you is that we've had a lot of fun putting the show together, and of course in a public dress rehearsal, I should warn you that there is the possibility that if something does go wrong in a safety way or in some major way, we may have to stop the performance. In every other way, we'll carry on. And what you will be seeing, of course, is a fairly rough cut version of what, in 3 weeks' time, at the end of our preview period, will be hopefully a very much more polished version of what you see today. So, and it's also, I must say, very nice to see such a big full house here tonight. I hope that's got nothing to do with the fact that all the tickets were free. And that all of you will be, tempted to rush out and buy a ticket to see the fully polished version when it appears on the 24th and the 5th of October, and that hopefully you won't buy your tickets from Keith Prowse. only kidding, because there's a new Keith Prowse, isn't there? Anyway, I won't talk anymore, but just to tell you that we're having a lot of fun here, and we hope you're enjoying it. That's all I want to say, except to cue our lighting designer and our lighting person who is going to press a switch when I say the hunting of the snark.
Thank you. hawks and hawks. They threatened its life with a railway share. They charmed it with smiles and soap.
Thank you.
extroverted, outgoing sort of man. Indeed, some thought me insular and rather strange. I was an intellectual, a professor of mathematics and logic at Oxford University. I had a passion for, and was in fact an early pioneer of photography. I was happiest in the company of children, but shy and uncomfortable with adults. I stammered and stuttered quite hopelessly. What a relief then it was to be able to change out of my personality as the Reverend Charles Lutwidge Dobson, to become the more liberated, charismatic, and magical Lewis Carroll. Cloaked in my new identity, I could walk freely into a world of fantasy and imagination. A dark but colorful world, peopled with talking caterpillars and March hares, the Jabberwock, and the Walrus and the Carpenter. It is into this world that I invite you tonight, on a journey of great significance, or of no significance, I leave the choice to you. As to how it happened, I was walking on a hillside alone one bright summer's day, when there came into my head one line of verse, one solitary line. For the snark was a Boojum, you see. Well, I knew not what it meant, but I went home and wrote it down. And sometime afterwards, the rest of the stanza occurred to me, that being the last line. And by degrees, and at odd moments over the next year or two, the rest of the poem pieced itself together, that being its last stanza. As to the meaning of snark, I'm very much afraid I didn't mean anything but nonsense. Still, you know, words mean more than we mean to express when we use them. So whatever good meanings are in the book, I'm glad to accept as the meaning. The best I've seen is from a lady who writes that the whole poem is an allegory on the search for...
Behold, you're out there. Behold, you're out there. And we're praying just in case.
Hymn number 302. We know you're out there. No snark of all snarks.
Behold, you're out there.
Learn to kill. But if you're out there, we believe that.
is out there, and it's hope that breeds belief, though it sometimes leads to grief. And though I'm firmly Christian, it must be right that every man should be free to go his way. Whatever's out there, they will surely find someday.
I'm a punk.
to believe it. Don't be in such a hurry to believe. I'll tell you why. If you set to work to believe everything, you will tire out the muscles of your mind. And you'll be so weak that you won't be able to believe the simplest true thing. Only last week, a friend of mine tried and set his mind to work to believe Alice in Wonderland. He managed to do it, but he was so exhausted by it that when I told him it was raining, which was true, he couldn't believe it and rushed out into the street without his hat or umbrella.
Who join me on this escapade?
Not me. I go to see when you can work in a bank like me.
What can you say? Your life's complete if you have never even tried. So I repeat, who join me on this escapade?
Not us.
Think of us when you've an occupation full of litigation and divorce.
Of course, but when you tie, what will they say? They'll say you never even tried to break away. They'll say you never even tried out on the dock and midnight sea to hunt the Snark with me.
Such an excellent quality.
And who can say his life's complete if he has never even tried?
So I repeat, who join me on this escapade?
I will. I've had my fill of waiting on the key for things to come to me. And if I die, I hope you'll say that at least the bank will try to break away.
We'll say at least the bank will try out on the dock and midnight sea to hunt the stars.
Such a romantic face, these things such boring pedantic days.
and rings, and the clothes he had bought for the trip. He had 42 boxes, all carefully packed, with his name painted clearly on each. But since he omitted to mention the fact, they were all left behind on the beach. He came as the baker, but Owen went too late, and it drove the poor bellman half mad. He could only bake bride cake, for which I may state, no materials were to be had.
I came as the baker on this escapade. I need the dough, but I can't look after the bread. The banker does it instead. And although I never feel afraid, somehow I know it could be the single worst mistake I ever made, to come as the baker on this escapade. I came as the butcher on this escapade, without the heart for the kill. It makes me want to be ill. My orders have to be obeyed. Though I take part, I'm not the one who the blame should all be laid. I'm only the butcher on the stairs and
to speak. But at length he explained in a tremulous tone there was only one beaver on board, and that was a tame one he had of his own, whose death would be deeply deplored.
I came as a beaver on his escapade, though I must say I'd only give all the fun. Optimist on the run. I'm not lost, I've only been mislaid. I know one day I'll find a sun. Now I'm walking in the shade. I'm only the beaver on the stairs of fate.
Thank you.
prone to arrange their disputes, and a broker to value their goods. A banker, though a billiard master whose skill was immense, might perhaps have won more than his share. But a banker engaged an enormous expense, and the whole of their cash in his care.
A banker engaged at enormous expense, had the whole of their cash in his care. We'll miss the tide if we don't leave now. Are you coming or not?
I'd love to come along if I could, but I must behave as a man. So in the event of a slowness, I must insist on a guarantee that the first of the light bulb will be me. It's the way we thank us. Last of all, like a banker, but first up, I should always be. If we go down in the raging sea, if anyone drowns, it won't be me. It's the way we back. Well, I am here with the perfect storm.
The moment one looked in his face, he served out some grog with a liberal hand and bade them sit down on the beach. And they could not but own that their captain looked grand as he stood and delivered his speech.
Thank you.
no heed to the fate of us. The rest is for the weakness, fool you. Ignore these words of dismay. Don't let the chance slip away.
This is the time to be strong.
The chips are down, the hunt is on.
To the day when you took me aboard of your ship to help you and help you to stop.
A dear uncle of mine, after whom I was named, remarked when I bade him farewell.
Oh, skip your dear uncle!
The bellman exclaimed as he angrily jingled his bell.
He remarked to me. He remarked. He remarked.
Said that mildest of men.
If your snark be a snark, that is right. Fetch it home, by all means. You may serve it with greens, and it's handy for striking the light.
That's exactly the method.
The bowman bowled in a hasty parenthesis cried.
That's exactly the way I have always been told that the capture of snarks should be tried.
You may seek it with thimbles, and seek it with care. You may pursue it with forks and hope, thread its life with a railway share, and charm it with smiles and soap. But oh, beamish nephew, beware the day your snark be a boojum. For then you will softly and suddenly vanish away, and never be met with again. Will be no more. is like nothing so much as a bowl brimming over with quivering curds. It is this. It is this.
We have had that before,
the bellman indignantly said, and the baker replied,
let me say it once more. It is this that I dread. I engage with the Snark every night after dark in a dreamy, delirious light. I serve it with greens in your shadowy seats, and I use it for striking a light. But if ever I meet with a Boojum, that day in a moment of this, I'm sure I shall softly and suddenly vanish away. And the notion I cannot endure.
The bellman looked puffish and wrinkled his brow.
If only you'd spoken before. It's excessively awkward to mention it now with a Snark, so to speak, at the door. The trouble with you is you think too much about what might go wrong. Instead of walking boldly on, you'll only make your fears come true. That's the trouble with you.
Trouble with me is I think too much. I'm really far too bright. I stay up worrying all night and wondering what this thing could be. That's the trouble with me. But the trouble with you is you're too blind to see what might befall you. All you do is to ignore feelings. Have you learned your feelings?
The trouble with you is you're brave enough, but far too insecure.
I may be sensitive, but you're the sort who blunders blindly through.
Trouble is if you always fear the worst, it's sure to find you. Mind you, do not fabricate danger, don't anticipate danger. Boojums probably aren't dangerous. Boojums probably aren't dangerous. Boojums probably aren't dangerous. What I tell you three times is true.
I know that it's true, that ignoring things will make them go. How can you think that if you say a thing three times it must be true?
Cause I'm wiser than you.
If ever I meet with a Boojum, that day in a moment of this I'm sure I shall softly and suddenly vanish away. And the notion I cannot endure.
Oh, it is a pitiful tale.
Said the bellman, whose face had grown longer at every word.
Now that you've stated the whole case, what we could be simply absurd. The rest of my speech,
he explained to his men,
you shall hear when I've let you to start. But the Snark is at hand. Let me tell you again, 'tis your glorious duty to seek it. To seek it with thimbles, to seek it with care, to pursue it with fondness and hope. To threaten its life with a railway share, to charm it with smiles and song. For the Snark's a peculiar creature that ought to be caught in a commonplace way. Do all that you know, and try all that you don't. Not a chance must be wasted today.
Be wrong all along, but at least it-
Snapping around. He skipped and he hopped and he floundered and fought. still fainting, he fell to the ground. And solemnly tolled on his bell. To the horror of all who were present that day, he uprose in full evening dress, and with senseless grimaces endeavored to say what his tongue could no longer express. Down he sank in a chair. In mimsiest tones, words whose utter inanity proved his insanity, while he rattled a couple of bones. The grinning slimy toes did gyre and gimble in the wave. All mimsy were the bongo and the moan rats out brave. Beware the jabberwock, my son, the jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the chub-chub bird, and shun the frumious bandersnatch. He took his mortal sword in hand. Long time the manxome foe he fought. So rested he by the tum-tum tree, and stood a while in thought. And as in uppish thought he stood, the devil! With eyes of flame, came whistling through the tulgy wood, and burbled as it came. One, two, and through, the lawful flame went snicker-knack. Ah, he left it dead.
Thank you. yet to be, of his good estate. And oh, I know we're well insured, and all the free of happy days.
Your reach, my friend. one day she's found.
I think my designs have been misunderstood, and it's not in my nature to turn on the schmaltz, but I want you to know my
Beaver, vanish.
the wall.
Then God, but where can he be?
Love is a game, shoot is the same, so join with you, get it too.
where the snark with a glass in its eye, dressed in gown, bands and wig, was defending a pig on a charge of deserting its sty.
with him. Is he fears a thing that isn't there at all? He thinks we're heading for a fall when it's so obviously clear that there's nothing to fear.
Trouble with him is the only thing he sees is faults in us. To him, there's nothing to discuss. It seems so dangerous to insist. Danger doesn't exist.
The trouble with them is it means too much.
The trouble with him is he dreams too much.
They pursued it with forks and hope. They threatened its life with a railway share. They charmed it with smiles and soap. Then the butcher contrived an ingenious plan for making a separate sally, and fixed on a spot unfrequented by man, a dismal, a desolate alley.
The job, keep count, I entreat. You will find out what are you to ask. Tis the song of the job. The proof is complete.
If only I've stated it right.
The beaver counted with scrupulous care, attending to every word. But he fairly lost heart and outgrave in despair when the third repetition occurred. Friends, as the beaver and butcher became, have seldom have ever been known. In winter or summer, it was always the same. You could never meet either alone. And if quarrels arose, as one frequently finds quarrels will, spite of every endeavor, the song of the Jub-Jub recurred to their minds and cemented their friendship forever.
Oh, Oh, it's hard to believe we could end our friends by the delicate combination of fear of the dark, belief in the dark, and intelligent conversation. Who would have guessed on this Wednesday night we would balance the whole equation? Who could have foreseen friendship between female Beaver and male Caucasian?
Thank you.
unmanned for a moment with noble emotions.
This amply repays all the wearisome days we have spent on the billowy ocean.
Thank you.
just a wild goose chase. We sailed for years till we found ourselves upon a beach, gaining on this beast from the realms of fiction. I've a strong conviction it's a thing we soon will.
I was too stubborn to
for three. That's trouble.
No.